joined the Kaggle 8 years ago. I Grandmasters competitions, but I also like to cameras, and I like to discuss in the forum in different competitions. I have experience in many different competitions, and the best possibility at Kaggle, I see, is that you can try different data sets much more different than you could use them. It's an also another nice exploratory data analysis kernel. You can check it later. And also you can see that there are orange and blue dots. Some intersections are in the test set, some are in the training. We will talk about it later. But on the right, you can see a few example images that you have to predict basically each intersection and each direction, whether a car is turning or not, what you have in the waiting time in that specific month and hour. And there are, of course, already available kernels, so you can basically just click and submit it. And you store the kernel, you can edit, and later you can climb the leaderboard. There was also a similar competition I took part in a few years ago. It was the New York taxi prediction challenge. I won't talk about it in details, but later you can check. It's also similar data. You have latitude and that longitude coordinate. In that competition, you have to predict the duration of the taxi trip from the source point to the target point. Here we have similar data, but we have to predict the waiting time in a specific intersection. So it's a smaller problem. So let's check the feature extraction steps. We have missing values and origin data, we have seen text, we have string names basically. We need to add interaction features, we could use external data, it's allowed in the competition. We have can add the frequency, including labeling, including distance from center, and many other features. I'm trying to go through the loop right now. Yeah, it should be seen. Okay. So, as I mentioned, there are already a lot of kernels available, and here I just take credit for others' work who suggested doing the feature extraction methods. If we import a few necessary packages, then you can see we have the training and test data read, and I combine them just for convenience, so we will apply each feature extraction step for them together. And originally we have almost a million records in the training set and almost a million records in the test set. We have lots of columns, statistics, and we already started adding a few features. If you just round the original latitude, you can see that it was a bit more precise. Then you get a single area kind of connection feature. You could also use external data to identify districts or other groupings, or you could use clustering for that. Only the streets were missing, so we'll use a very simple feature just to measure whether it was missing or not. Sometimes missing data can add information as well. We can combine the city ones, weekend and hour. Basically, this four variable is quite important for your prediction, depending whether it's rush hour or people are commuting to office or back from the office, the same intersection could have a completely different distribution. And there is just a nice way to encode the entry heading and exit heading. It was called as the originally was provided as southwest, northeast, southwest, northeast, and stuff like that. You can encode it to integers or even to the radian to measure how much you turn from one intersection to the other. And it's easier to feed the decision trees we will use later. A few participants already added other features, so if you have outside external data for better statistics, you can add to this original data set as well. You can join it based on the city, the months, and fortunately it could reveal some patterns as well. And since the intersection ID wasn't unique in the whole training set, unique per city, we can add and concatenate the city and the intersection to get unique intersections for the full training and test set. It could be also a useful feature whether the intersection and the car going through the traffic lane has the same entry and exit street. We could standardize the coordinates, and after standardization, we could also use the distance from the city center. In the city center, you might expect longer radar times, but at least we can help the model to figure it out, not from the origin coordinates, but from the distance from the city center. And another useful trick I learned in Kaggle competition. it shows that sometimes the frequency of records could help to predict additional variables. So the idea behind this, if you have lots of measurements from the same intersection, then maybe it could be busier than other intersections. So we could use just a simple count to measure how many data points we have in these specific categorical variables. And instead of giving the categorical variable to the decision tree later, we could use the frequency encoded version. So for example, for each intersection, we will have the number of data points we measured in that intersection in total training test set. Also, you could use unique counts to count how many different intersections you have in the data set. And for the last but not least, for the original text data set, we filled the missing values and we need to transform these categorical text features. We just use a simple label encoder and transform them to numeric features to have the next boost. So let's go back to the presentation. We have all kinds of extracted features. If I just rerun the notebook, it will take 10 minutes, so I don't have that much time. I won't go into details about XGBoost. Probably many of you are familiar with it. Basically, it has decision trees based on splitting the data on the features. You can train lots of decision trees and combine them to help each other and improve the overall performance. But XGBoost and other decision tree-based like gradient boosting models and lots of different parameters, number of iterations, child rate, or the learning rate. So you have to optimize lots of them. In Kaggle Days Paris, Luca Massarone had a nice version how to tune the parameters. You could check those materials. Maybe it would be useful if you would like to put it in this competition later. And at the end, we can check the baseline submission. Again. Let's just go through this notebook. We will have a 50% training set and 50% validation to speed it up. You can change the kernels in the environment, so when you have an output data set, you can load it into the next kernel by adding the data set from the output. And this way we already have in this kernel the pre-calculated features. And what I was talking about, we have actually 6 different targets. We have to predict the 20 percentile for 50 percentile and 80 percentile for 2 different waiting time statistics, the total time and the distance which the car had. We did exclude a few useless variables. It doesn't really matter whether it's train or the class, it's just the original text variable. Row ID isn't useful for the prediction, at least it shouldn't be. I also added random just for the validation, so we disclude a few features. Here you can check the training statistics. We have lots of values with only a few distinct items, like we have 4 cities, we have 2 flag values for the weekend, and we have more numeric-like features like the longitude distance that have 160 different variables values also. So let's use a few default XGBoost parameter. We will set the mean child rate to 20, 85%. We will use 60% of the features for each. And we allow 20 depth signs. I have the usual, but it will have the missing code. Then we can train the model for each different target. And the targets are not the same, so they have different variants, and the group is squared error is basically the group is squared error for each of the six targets. So you can see that this is the median of the distance. It has a group is squared error of 47, but the 80% percentile of the same variable is larger, but it has a larger variation. Also, this support has an error. So we combine the total group discard that we have a validation set and training set, and we say it's 40, and it's time to connect. Again, this will take more than 30 minutes, so I won't recommend to run it. But we can go back to the slides, and it could have around 64 on the leaderboard. It's nice, but if you remember, then our local validation set is 40. There is something fishy here. Usually you shouldn't expect that much difference from the local validation score and from the training, from the leaderboard score. So there is something fishy. I'm not sure how many of you heard the adversarial validation, but it's usually a technique when you try to predict which record is in the train or in the test set. And if you can predict that, then it's a good indicator that they have different distribution. And another carrier, Ian, already did this, and he found that the AUC was above 70%, so that's completely different from what you should expect from a random distribution. And it's already obvious that the geographical coordination is important to split between train and test sets. Here I took some investigation and checked the EEG perception, whether it's in the train set, they are the green dots, or in the test set, they are the red dots, or in most of the train and test set, and they are the orange dots. And you can see that there are three different sections for each city actually, and there was a trick applied for the training and test set. And for some of the intersections, you have training data and test data. For those intersections in the bottom, you can build a model which overfits to those intersections because you already know those intersections. If you go a bit higher, then there are mixed red and green dots. You can see there that you don't know the exact same intersection from the past, but you can know nearby intersections, so maybe you can know the intersections from the same street, or the closest intersection is known for you. You can still build useful models for that. And you have completely unseen districts where you don't have any training data at all. You can use very basic models for that to avoid overfitting. And if we have if we want to climb the leaderboard, I mentioned to you that there will be a competition at the end. There are six different kernels. We can try to build a model for these intersection splits. We can try to build separate models. For the orange one, we will build models trained on all the data, and we will allow further overfitting parameters for the decision trees. And for the red ones, where we don't know the exact intersection, we won't use, for example, the intersection ID because it wouldn't be useful for the model. And we also train the model with more conservative modeling parameters. So here you can see that what happens when we combine the results. The original perfect DBX she boost has 64. Miscarriage error, the above generalized model has 71, so actually it's worse than our previous approach. But if we combine these two models and apply the overfitting model to the originals, and we apply the general model for the rest, then we can have quite a good result. And I would like to show this is the overfitting model. So there won't be too much difference. Basically, it's the same kernel. We also use a few feature importance variables here for further analysis. And here we basically just create a training set based on random on each row. And in the general model, we will create a random variable for each intersection, and this way for the validation set. And when we try to use early stopping for the XGBoost, then we will have the intersection random to decide to stop when unseen intersections start decrease the performance. And another good thing that this general model is a bit closer to the leaderboard score. So it assumes that it's 66 mean squared error and on the leaderboard we saw 71. It's still a bit distant, but at least we can know that combining more specifically fitted, overfitted model for the orange dots and applying more general model for the unseen intersections is a good direction. And for the combination, I will show this kernel in details as well, because again, we don't have to retrain all our models, so you can change kernels. And I will try to copy and edit this one. So you can see that it has in the input. If you don't see this, you can click on the top right corner. It has several different inputs. And actually you can add data, whether it's your data set or kernel input file. You can easily combine different kernels. And since we added all the different features and the overfitted model and the XGBoost general, let's just start with assembling the predictions. We will create a variable, that's well known, whether we have seen the intersection in the test set, in the trial set. We will also open the overfitted models. Let's just check what is in the overfitted model. Still reading the CSV files. So for each intersection and target code, you have an estimation what will be the distribution. So it could be meter or second, that doesn't really matter for us. We need to optimize this column and make a submission. So we can merge between different datasets based on the target ID, so based on intersection and target column. Okay. it will take some time. And at the end, I will just split the original row ID back to intersection ID, and we will merge whether this intersection was seen in the training set or not. And we will use the general model for seen intersections, and we will use the overfitted model for the seen intersections or known intersections. And we have known intersections for 66% of the total test set. So here we can see the final result. It didn't take too long because the features were already calculated, the models were already tamed, and you just had to use their predictions to combine the results, and actually writing the submission file is probably the most resourceful step for this notebook. And at the end, when you are finished, you can commit and you can submit to the competition. Another interesting trick that it won't happen in many real life cases, but decision trees are sensitive for unseen data sets. So if the feature statistic is completely different for the training and test set, it could happen that they produce invalid results. So both for the waiting time and the waiting meter distance, all the data set didn't have negative values. But in the prediction, we can see that the overfitting target has quite a large negative values. And if you are predicting this square error, it could hurt your individual records. And since you are calculating the square of the error, it could hurt your value. So it's good to apply some sanity check. So we just transform the target variable and clip all the below zero or negative records. Do not submit garbage which we know that we don't have. And at the end, this was just about 3 minutes execution time. You might be talking, you can commit it, and there isn't any random step, so it should be give you the same results. So let's move back to the presentation. So, as I started, it's actually a big dash of the intersection challenge, and the prizes for the competition, it will be in December, so if you are interested in this playground competition, you will still have time. It's sponsored by BigQuery, and BigQuery is basically a really nice scale infrastructure for data warehouses, and even at my company, we use it quite a lot. You can move terabytes of data with it, and it's scalable. Usually it has the same response time for 1 terabyte query and for a few megabyte query. For this specific competition, the data set isn't that big. So if you just select a few columns, BigQuery is also columnar. So if you just read certain columns from the original data set, you will get the cost of the query. Will be basically how much data it has to be. So it's not, I won't talk too much about BigQuery, but since it's the main objective of the competition, and you have to apply BigQuery machine learning models to be able to work by these prizes, you might want to check it. It has limited models, so I was talking about XGBoost before, but it has linear models. Logistic regression and multi-class logistic regression won't help you because they are actually classification models. But it also has nearest neighbors model. It's also good for regression. And if you have more resources and time, then you could apply pre-trained TensorFlow models and import them basically in the BigQuery. And the main advantage would be actually similar stuff at work. We use linear regression models, and this way you don't need to extract features from the original dataset and load them to a machine and apply a standard Python or whatever model you have. You can directly execute the query on the data, and it will be much more, the results will be much more fast, because you don't need to move your data from the data center to another data center to start workers. The query behind the scenes do all the necessary steps for you. So it's a really cost efficient way to apply in production machine learning models. Here I will just show you a few further tips. In the other competition, we have to create clusters for the different coordinates and intersections. And sometimes for decision trees, it's also useful on the right if you apply rotation for the original latitude and longitude to the coordinates. Because decision trees usually split by vertical or horizontal lines. If you use PCA, it might transform the data to preserve the largest variance in both directions. So the PCA transform data set and rotate it in two dimensions could be actually useful. Again, for the next example, I want to recommend you to see the week, because you have limited time, limited resources. You will probably still able to try a few different stuff. So what I haven't done so far in my career was feature selection. So we still have a few features in the original canvas which might be garbage. We don't know whether weather is helpful or not, but it's among the variables. We didn't really use the consolidation, so it's just a simple 50% split for training, 50% split for validation. We could apply the training for all the data set, but that will also take some time, so you have to make considerations how much time you would allow. You could use blending. It's quite common, especially for square dialogue problems. If you have a different kind of predictions, it could be already calculated Kaggle output files or different kind of models. If you just average them or use a weighted average, then usually you decrease the error rate and you will get a better model than you would have from just the best single model you have. And it doesn't require that much resources. You could further apply the latitude split, because we have seen that there are intersections or areas where we don't know anything about the streets, so those could be those probably need special attention. We could also apply target encoding. So in the features I didn't add target encoding. I'm not sure if probably you heard it in the last day. So when you have a categorical feature and you apply for that categorical feature to replace each value with the mean target, then you can have a nice predictive feature usually. But you have to make sure that your training data and training target won't leak into your validation set. So it's a bit tricky. And you can also use different models. I used XGBoost. Nowadays, IGBM are even more popular than technical competitions, and I heard that it's sometimes it's faster and it gives you more power. So if you like IGBM, it might be the chance to try to do this data set even in the next hour. And thank you. I will go to the competition and I will share a few tricks. So, if it will load, then we will check the public leaderboard. So what would be the best? If you could join to the competition, you are doing it today. I didn't publish my best result so far. So it's a similar technique that I showed you. It's basically the same concept I used in these six public areas I shared with you. And you can also find other notebooks and other works in this project. If you are looking for the feature extraction of other kernels I showed you, you just have to use the tutorial tag, and you can find in order all the kernels I showed you before. And there are other useful notebooks you can learn from. So again, you won't have that much time. We should finish by 5:30 or so. So you will have basically 1 hour to make a submission. And the dataset is, isn't that big, but it has 1 million rows. So unfortunately, you won't be able to download it and copy-paste the code to kernels. So you have to make a kernel submission here. Otherwise, probably you will have issues as you had today. So, how to submit? You have to join the competition and for the notebook probably and work with that. And if you could apply for your team name, and here we are talking about single teams, please do not team up in this competition. It happens in regular competitions that you have to compete alone. And you can add the KDC, Kaggle Days China tag to your name, and also the WeChat ID, then the organizers will be able to call you at the award ceremony. So I would recommend you to start competing if you still have the capacity and are not completely exhausted. And how to find the competition? It's the big Kaggle intersection congestion competition in Kaggle. It should be a playground competition in the bottom on the competitions page. So thank you and best of luck, and anyway, after that, there will be